Go figure out what your voice is without the constraints of the platform. Are you rolling?
Yeah,
okay, okay. I am constantly cringing at myself and my work.
I was told these would be easy questions.
Hi, my name is Rega and I'm so excited to be here with Commune to answer questions that apparently you have sent in. So, should we start?
Hi, Rega. I have just one question. Can you tell us on the purpose of humanity? Thanks.
I would first of all like to say thank you, Viswar, for this incredibly easy interview question. You know, if I can just be very simplistic about it, maybe it's just to leave everything like slightly better than we found it. Like everything. Any, like a room you enter, leave it slightly. A person you meet, leave them slightly. You know? And the world though, of course. And we are fully on track with that one, as we all know. This is a question from someone named Srihita. How do you deal with rejections, personal or professional? How do you build your self-confidence up post-rejection? Bold of you to think that I have built any self-confidence up from any rejection. Yeah, what I just said is in a sense true in that, you know, some aspects of my confidence sort of remain shaken over a long term from certain types of rejections. But in another sense, of course, we have all dealt with not having gotten many jobs that we've applied for and not having gotten many people that we've applied for. And how do I deal? You know, I sort of try to, as often as possible, remind myself of the like actually chaotic nature of most things, which is to say more specifically that I don't assume that most things that happen in my life, both, you know, achievements and acceptances and rejections and failures, had too much to do with me. I think I don't take on too much of a sense of control over them. When someone is rejecting me, I like, you know, assume that, yeah, it could be because I'm terrible. It could be because they are going through something that makes me not the right writer or partner or whatever else. Whatever you need consolation for, Srihita, there's a chance it's not actually a referendum on you as a being or your skill or your validity for whatever it is that you want it. There's a universe of factors that determine which rooms we end up in and which people we end up with. And I try to keep that in mind.
Hi, Rega. This is Kajal. I think in this time of social media, artists, and I mean, I know this because I write as well, we get really affected by how many likes a post is going to get. We let that seep into our work. We forget about wondering whether people will like it from their heart. We neglect whether we are liking the process of creating that piece. And that's what I want to ask you. How do you deal with this? How do you stay true and authentic to your own voice?
I'd say I think we're probably tasked like dually a little bit. I think it's a very good idea and I can't recommend it enough. And everyone who follows me know I take the liberty to do this relentlessly, which is disappear. Disappear from the platform. Go write for yourself. Write for your friends, write for a journal no one reads, or, you know, a niche magazine that will give you the 5,000 words to explore that one topic that you can't shut up about, but which your Instagram followers don't care about. Do it. Go figure out what your voice is without the constraints of the platform. But, you know, the true unbeatables, I think the MVPs, the GOATs, are the ones who have figured out their own voice and their own style, but aren't too fussed about adapting it for a medium or a platform when they need to, because you want to write what you want to be read also.
Hey Rega, you know I love you. I have a question for you today, and it's something we've talked a little bit about in the past, but I'd love to hear where you're at now. Do you have any words of advice or reflections you'd like to share on making one's way out of the good girl complex and the productivity trap? I know that I talk about sex on the internet for a living, and so it might seem like I've managed to work my way out of both, but if I'm honest, in real life, I find it quite near impossibly hard to extricate myself from either. But I feel like you might have some answers.
Lisa, first of all, You're so good. Thank you. I do think we'd be hard pressed to find anyone who has thrashed out of the good girl mold as radically as you have, because yes, while you are conventionally successful in many ways, you are successful specifically at telling hundreds of thousands of women how to have pleasurable sex, which is like, thanks, man. Thanks. That is not in any of our sanskars. The productivity trap is that's a insidious one. But I know that where I've arrived for myself is, my friends are gonna make fun of me if they watch this. A friend and I recently did the math and I calculated that given good health, I have something like 4.5 lakh hours left to live. Let's just not spend all of that time working. There's just no need. I just know for a fact now that I'm happiest when I'm sitting quietly with my friends, examining their hearts and minds. I am happiest when I'm awed by something that has, you know, moved me. I am very happy working also, actually. I'm quite thrilled when I'm feeling useful. But to just do it, just to keep amassing acquisitions that we won't ever need, that has stopped feeling important. And the way it has stopped feeling important is by really focusing on that 4.5 lakh hours. Tishita is asking, how did you get into journaling? Well, Tishita, via depression. My therapist recommended it during the most baffling year of my life. I won't describe it as the worst year of my life because it isn't like, you know, there were terrible things happening as much as my mind had started to sort of lose a grip on, you know, what was real and what was just internally manufactured self-loathing and doubt. Aside from, I mean, it was my own therapist and then the wider universe of mental health recommendations on the internet, among whom journaling was one recommendation. For me, forming sentences is the easiest way to actually sort of capture a thought or capture an experience. So I got into journaling via like a very regimented 5 minutes a night routine, and at that point it was sort of very templated. It was, I would write every night, I would write down three moments in the day that felt good, and I would write down three things that I had learned during the day, and I would just do it for 5 minutes a night. And I really emphatically credit it with my eventually feeling much better. But then it also, you know, I'm so glad to have begun it at all. Because even, I mean, it has stuck post-depression, and it's now something that I don't really do out of a need to feel good as much as out of a need for clarity at any given point. I think it's just one of many ways that a person can get good at understanding what they themselves are experiencing, and it has worked very well for me.
Hi, Rega. I think this is such a good thing that the commune is doing. They're asking you your most favorite things, that is questions. I can't really wait to see what answers you'll have to all the things people are asking you. One thing I was thinking about is, I know your favorite way of asking questions is sitting in a living room and chit-chatting. And I know that being on video might be stressing you out a little bit. I think what will be good for everyone to know is how you spoke to yourself before starting this, and whether it was an uncomfortable conversation, and how you self-soothed. Because I know you're the queen of self-soothing, and I think it'll really be good for everyone to know how to talk to yourself. Which brings me to the actual question, which is, what are the essential elements of how to talk to yourself in moments of relative discomfort or distress?
First of all, I just love this question so much, and it has greatly overwhelmed me. My God, I'm gonna... like going to tear up while I speak, and I'm trying not to, even though it would make for great content for commune, I know. But this is a very kind question. This is such a loving question. And to answer the question, I spoke to myself with curiosity. I tried to answer for myself what it was that I was so worried about, and actually articulate it rather than just accepting that there is something to be anxious about, sort of went at it in an investigative way. Just like, is there really anything to be so stressed about? Maybe there isn't. And then I spoke to myself with compassion, which is to say, you know, I accepted that there might be good reason for me to be stressed, and that it's okay. It's okay to be stressed. It's okay to not be a person who's thrilled on camera. And then I said to myself some of the things I would to a good friend, which is, well, maybe they're lies. Maybe they're, but we're never lying when we say them to friends. When we say to friends, no, you are perfectly likable, and actually you are very articulate, and you are absolutely qualified to be doing this thing you have been asked to do. We aren't lying when we say those things to our close friends. We feel like we're lying when we say them to ourselves. And so I think that might be why it's overwhelming to suddenly see the face of a very close friend who knows, who knows exactly what I'm feeling right now and what I had to tell myself to be here. But yeah, I do think with, you know, the way to encounter ourselves in stress is with curiosity and compassion, and in the way that we would any of our closest friends.
Hi Rega, my first question to you is, what are your top 3 tips/hacks on dealing with the haters or people just generally being snarky to each other constantly on social media? My second question is, what does friendship mean to you, and does friendship play a part in your work/creative process?
Friendship with you means the world to me, Priyanka. Get as pissed off as you want and vent to your friends. DM me anytime, Priyanka. Yeah, so I think that anger has to be voiced. I used to have this, you know, like, holier than thou, bigger person mindset. Like, no, come on, forgiveness, compassion, this, that. Someone's being mean to you, fine. Be mad. That's valid. As second, maybe do draw on some of that compassion, sympathy, empathy. Because I will just say, I've never known someone who's having a good day who thought that the perfect way to top it off was to go be an to a stranger on the internet. That's not a thing. To some extent, I try not to take it too personally, but of course I do take it incredibly personally, and it affects me greatly. Well, okay, if it is criticism from a person who I think is authorized to give me criticism, then I'll actually think about it. And so the tiny sliver of online hate that falls in that third category of actually possibly useful, we somehow have to have it in us to learn from, I guess. I don't know how. But all I know for sure is that it's very important to vent to your friends and be mad at your haters together. I think that is, like, crucial coping. The second question. Friendship to me is utter safety. The warmth of a room in which you can express anything without thinking too much about it. Knowing that even if it isn't agreed with or accepted, it will be seen in the most generous possible way, in the most patient possible way. My friends are my first draft recipients. They're all much smarter than me. They've all read more than me. They write better than me. So the role that friends play is they are, you know, everything from muses to editors to managers to agents to the best critics also. You know, the best critics, because they are the gentlest critics, the wisest, most generous critics. They are the assurance that, you know, even if these 100,000 people hate what you've done, friends are the assurance that at the end of that awful day, I can still close the door, sit in this, you know, living room with these 3 people who truly love me, and those 100,000 people are not here, so my life is okay. Nirali says, Rega is the biggest goofball I know. She's always feeling mischief, as she says. I do say that. Mischief is a very important emotion to me. From pranks to voices to jokes, she does it all. But Instagram Rega is so, so serious. I wanted to ask if and when the world will get to see goofball Rega, or is it just reserved for me? One thing that I have spent most of my 20s tormented by, which is how much of myself is owed to an audience of strangers. How much do I get to just keep? How much do I, you know, my friends deserve, my family? Instagram has seen my writing. It has seen me as an editor when I was an editor, which are all, you know, at the time, just what I was making my living off of. So I think I will only feel compelled to reveal a, you know, funny side of myself if at any point there is anything in it for me. I don't think I any longer, I did earlier in life, but I no longer really just feel a need to be simply liked. There's no inherent urge to just have all of me expressed and accepted. Mel has asked a very good question, which is, how do you overcome imposter syndrome or feeling like a fraud when you're a writer. I very much feel a sense of imposter syndrome and fraudness at all times. Yeah, like even at a point where I had published, you know, over 100 pieces of writing in the world, I still at one point had to write a bio for my own website and wrote the sentence, "I Rega Jha as a writer," and was like, is she? Can you say that? Can anyone just say that? It's like, no, anyone can't, but once you've done the work, you really should be able to. So I don't know, I guess by doing it. I guess that's the only way I've overcome it. You know, especially with Instagram and social media, I think a lot of us start having to behave very important and professional before we actually are. And we start having to promote ourselves before we've done very much. Because that's all sort of part of the same game now. It isn't so much that, you know, like you practice writing for 5 years and then you publish in somewhat without too much fanfare for a few more years and then you sort of receive the accolades. Now it's from the get-go, you are expected to be cheerleading yourself as someone who really matters and a voice that's very important to the world. And I think, of course, a lot of us feel confused by that when we ourselves are, you know, 22 and 23 and 25 years old. And we are having to pretend to be much more together and much more sort of refined and confident than we are. It is going to catch up with us at night that we're sort of lying to people. So I think to some extent, if your conscience is reminding you every now and then that you aren't necessarily being fully honest with yourself or other people, that might be a working conscience.
Hi Rega, this is Jagriti, a constant reader of your Sunday column and your newsletter Small Scenes. What I observed is a pattern in your writing is that you bring in a lot of personal experience to the table that helps me connect to your writing more. So today, my question is, how do you manage to bring so much vulnerability in your writing? Because I'm constantly afraid if I bring in personal experiences or my own vulnerabilities, it will make people see me differently. So I hope you can answer this. Thank you.
That's a really lovely question. I don't know if I consider it a scary thing that people will see me differently, because ultimately, like, I am still in full control of what makes it to the final piece. So of course they will see me differently, but it's on my terms, I think. Of course, all of us sadly lack complete self-awareness. So often we will give ourselves away in ways that we have no idea we're doing. So it is a risk. It is absolutely a risk. And I will say that I myself absolutely don't want to give the impression that I, you know, write these pieces that are full of personal detail and then I feel, you know, totally hunky-dory and not at all nervous about it. I am constantly cringing at myself and my work, which is to say, like, yeah, a column might be published Sunday morning and Sunday night, my face alone in my bedroom, physically I will be doing this, being like, how could I just tell everyone that? But by then it's usually told and there's nothing else to do. You've read it already and you have been so generous about it. So while I'm cringing, and it might be valid that there are some people who are not seeing me generously, it's usually been the case that some other people are. And that is another thing that's not actually in my control. All I can do in the writing is do my best to use my own life wisely, I guess, and then hope that I still stand by 3 years later, which I almost never do, but we try.
Hi Rega, I can finally ask you something that I've always wanted to ask you, because I think it's one of your most special qualities. It's a special power that you have. I know of you as someone who has the power to make people feel things, whether it is through your words or through your actions or just by being you, the person that you are. You've been able to make people feel their vulnerability, you make people feel empowered, you give people a chance to feel nostalgia, you make them feel warm with your words. My question to you then is, how do you wish to be remembered by the world?
The this is another one of those scam questions where like someone just says very nice things about you and then in the last 2 seconds they're like, oh yeah, my question. But it's also a very beautiful question, Anubhuti, thank you. The best type of compliment I've ever received is from people who would come, young women, and sometimes, you know, just young people who would come and say that this thing you wrote, my friends and I had a lovely evening talking about. And the reason that made me feel so nice is because it's not about me. If I could, like, you know, snap my fingers and invent a custom in the world named after me, it would just be very small groups of friends, no more than, like, even five is pushing it. I'd say 3 to 4 is ideal. Sitting in a room that is not very loud, and they can, you know, whatever, their own choice of intoxicants, whoever wants whatever, and they are being very honest with each other. It is the best thing I have been told that my work has created. It is my favorite thing to do. I think it's crucial to all of us, like, having survived and continuing to survive. I don't think anyone can make us feel as much as the people we love can. Thank you all for watching this, and thanks in particular to the very many people who have written in and recorded videos and sent in questions and just so much validation. Like, I don't know what to do with it. I've short-circuited a little bit. But it really means a lot to know that one is not creating into a void, of course. I have often thought that the most generous and thoughtful gift that anyone can give to an artist is, or a creator of any sort, is a good question. And y'all gave me some 500, so actually, I don't know how many you gave me, but I feel like there were many. So what I can tell you is that I'm going to be thinking about a lot of these concepts and questions for a long time to come, and I had so much fun, and yeah, thank you for reading me, and thank you, Commune, for having me.
I asked him, aapne ye kyun banaya, kya soch kar banaya, kab banaya, kyun banaya, and what was the thought that you had when you made this? And he replied with the most innocent face, pata nahi, I don't know why I'm doing this, ye chal raha hai aur mujhe pata nahi hai kyun. And I don't know why, the next thing that I told him, hame kisi ko nahi pata hota hai ki hum kya kar rahe hain. Hamare jitne bhi jawab hai ki hum ye isliye kar rahe hain, hum usliye kar rahe hain, wo sirf duniya ke khano ko bharne ke liye hain.